In Cambridge, I've been battling this issue with our city from 2010 to 2012. As of January 2012, after going to council many of times, trying to get the closets in place, rolling closets, keys, and all that stuff, they did a vote to reconsider on January 2012 not to consider this policy. I'm one landlord that won't take no for an answer, so I contacted the local NPC, Rob Mullen, in the city of Cambridge, and I told him what our questions were and how the ripple effect of this bylaw is. And he said, hey, Kayla, I think you should get a petition going. So I said, okay, let me see how to write a petition. So I contacted Mark Henry. He's the lawyer at the firm. He had the article you might have seen outside. It wasn't good on this issue, and this is how I found him. So I ended up getting him to write up a nice petition. It was being passed around from the city to city, property manager, real estate agent, anyone who does work for a landlord. And this way, we were able to get this petition circulating across the province. So far today, I'm sure that it all figures could be a lot more because of knowing on what I've collected. It's about 400 signatures. And we're talking about courts and we're talking about tackling the problem. The one thing that's happening right now is that with the province and the municipal act is up for review every 5 years. This is the year. If we're going to make some noise, we need to make noise now and we need to make our voices heard. We started going from, I had my first rally on March 20th in Cambridge, well, besides the council rallies and rallying in front of City Hall, I finally had a formal one that people know that we really going to be part of it. About 80 people showed up. We had Federation of Rental Housing Providers of Ontario. We had Mark Hannover from Toronto who came down. We had real estate investors because they're very scared of the situation and how it's turning away investments in the city. And that was a great success. Our videos are actually on Ontario Landlord's Watch, the cards are outside, and that's where we're putting every bit of information. This data in here will be on this site. We're going to show them that I'm circulating this petition and showing that we're not taking it, because we don't have the money to go to work. Like, we're showing $50,000, but we're coming up against our municipality, and we're coming up against our province. They will run you out of time, and they will run you out of money. So the only way to go is to stand strong, stand together, and make sure that we have our facts straight. People are trying to think right now that this is just landlord's issue. It's not just the landlord. The tenants should be also scared. Because now the tenants are going to be scared because the landlords are now having the power of who goes into their unit. Now what's happening is that the people who sit underneath a high risk, they will be definitely turned down because no one wants to be responsible for the delinquent water bill. Then we have how many people are going into the property. I'm not going to take a family of five no more. I'm going to want one or two. And believe it or not, it's part of the human right where you can't discriminate against people, but this is what landlords have to do. I just spoke to a man in Winston last night. Found his article 12 days ago when the news was spread there. He had a $580 water bill. Pretty cheap for a delinquent water bill for Winston. We're looking at $800 to $1,000 in delinquent water bill. And a lot higher than other cities. So I started talking to him. He told the council that he was out $3,500. $580 for the water, $3,000 for the rent that he didn't pay. And he got laughed at by his council. Laughed at. He felt so low, he felt like a criminal, he said. And said, what can you do? So I told him, here's the decision. He was so excited to get the petition being circulated as far as we can bring it. Because now the tenants are now in I don't think the court is the best way to go, because you will run out of time and money. I started a site with the Ontario Homeless Watch. We have sponsors. We have companies who are sponsoring us to help us get to where we need to go, and photocopies that we need to do. Everything that involves us getting the information out, they're helping us find donations. They're providing the receipts. If they call me up and say, hey, Kayla, where's the money going? I can tell you each receipt and the invoice for it. But this is the only way, and it's still endless. You don't even want to give in a little bit of money, because they haven't gotten burned yet. And this is when we're struggling in the land. You can call us for all your hands up that we're struggling. We have less rights, and we need more rights and less responsibilities. Because I'm telling you, we had outside of Toronto there was a man who got charged $500 because of the tenant on such a fire truck. Like, I don't know what else you gotta do to take care of your people, but they're probably not gonna be one of the landlords. Make sure that you are able to cover the property, the mortgage, the insurance, and that tenant for at least 5 months. And we know that we can't keep these people out as fast as we possibly can, because there's so many essential lists, and the courts do that. But the thing is, municipalities know that water is being a human right, and they will pass on to the next person that they possibly do. And they believe landlords are rich, they believe we have the money. Well, if we do have the money, whatever money we have, let's put it into this product and show them what we're made of. So the next time we have a different renewal, we're actually here and we're actually socializing as a major group. Because I have people from West Elgin, Toronto, Nipissing, Scarborough, Peterborough, Toronto, how many places?
Of course, the length, we could go on and on.
But I've contacted many, many landlords and many cities in the province. We're already gathered, now we just need your city on board, and Susan's going to hold you guys as much as she can. And she's doing great right now. She's got you here, she's got you lobbying, she's got petitions for you to sign, and she's got coffee out front. So we're able to thank Susan again for all the hard work that she did for tonight. We just need to get more people involved, as many people, and the next rally that we're hosting is going to be in Ottawa on April 28th at 6 o'clock. I know it's a good drive, but then we're hoping to be back in this area near the London, Sarnia area, and that way we can gather again as a big team. So we have a good time frame between May and June where everyone can do the word of mouth, and we can get together and modulate the local group and keep talking about it. Get on Twitter, get on the website, make you are also being discriminated against as a landlord. You have to do something, because no one's going to do it for you. You have to get onto your local SBC. Call your local SBC. You let them know that you're protesting this, that you joined the Ontario Landlords Watch, to make sure that we get this provincial legislation changed. And the next rally, I'm going to have my cell phone. For every landlord that shows up, we're going to have a little meeting area, so that you can call the minister of municipal affairs and housing, Catherine Nguyen, and you're going to raise your voice down. And then if you get 80 landlords or more to say, whoa, go to the newspaper, say, Catherine Nguyen, that 80 messages from angry landlords. Now we're putting her in a spot to do something, because they're not going to do something unless you have the numbers. And we need the numbers. But so far, 400 signatures that I know for sure is what I have. I still don't know the NCC, WNC, and Simcoe North who are collecting decisions on behalf of the system. But we just need to keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And the way to do that is to keep contacting each other. My phone number is on the website. You can call me up anytime.